I was actually periodically reviewing your scripts on CBE practice platform on the go, meaning as you were answering, I was from time to time checking your scripts to see. I'll hopefully by Thursday or Friday, let me be practical, by Friday I'll be done marking the first batch, you know. You know, when we are now having these lectures, part of it is a feedback already that I'm giving you concerning the manner in which you were answering the previous questions. So consider this lecture as a debrief. You'd notice that as I am presenting how we answer questions, SBR questions, you may actually relate to how you have answered it on the practice platform so that you can improve from there. Today we have a bias on groups. Hopefully we will not discuss groups again. So we do have a bias on groups. So first things first, it would make sense if can anyone share the video on groups, There are two videos that we have on groups. Can someone share in our WhatsApp class group? Can you share the, I'm sure those were the second, just share the links, or if I can share the links myself, I'm sure I can share myself, don't worry. Because the concepts we are going to discuss were fully discussed in these particular links that I want to share here. So if you had joined us late, and though I know I have already sent the groups the links on groups, I as well do that. You know, we always do that. So that you don't, well, it appears it's taking me long to scroll back to groups. So what I will do is I will actually like consolidating foreign operations, that right, groups illustrations. So these are the two videos on groups. There is a explanatory video on groups. There is an explanatory video on groups. Let me copy the link. Copy link address file. And let me paste it here. This is a very important video. This is the video I was talking about. A video where I was explaining quite a lot of things and quite a lot of concepts on groups. I shall send the other video about illustrations on groups, so that we have complete those two videos plus the today's video plus the other revision we had on groups again. They will suffice for us to answer. Then last week we didn't have a revision lecture, and what I did last week is I did send you the discussion, which was discussion on June. Okay, so this one was March June 2019 question paper. So it's fine. So are you noticing that March June 2019 question paper? I did send a video last week. So I had already singled it out for today's revision. I had singled it out for today's revision when I said number one. So because we already have the video, so this one is already covered. So March June 2019, we are no longer going to discuss it. So the whole paper is covered. This is already covered in the video below. I'm just putting everyone here into. Am I sharing my screen here? Oh no, I'm supposed to be sharing my screen. Right? I'll be sharing my screen shortly. Let me see what is causing me not to share my screen. You know, the camera is acting up and time's not allowing me to share my screen. Okay. So I am sending everything. What I'm discussing here is in our class WhatsApp group. So I'm saying, as you can see, I said let us discuss March June 2019 question one. So I'm now saying this is already covered in the video below. So you need to play this video for March 2019. I sent this video last week. I'm just hoping that everyone has played it. If you haven't, let me copy the same video here and again send it to you here. All right, so there you go. So this is the revision on the wallpaper of March June 2019. This is the revision there. So what it means is today we are left with discussing ZIPO group Zippo group. That's what we are left with to discuss today. But let me again finish my video inventory. There's another video I want you to play, which is the video on groups illustrations. Let me fish it out. It is way back there. These two groups, they consider these two videos, they don't consider groups which are in foreign currency, you know, consolidating foreign operations. There's another video on groups where we are consolidating foreign operations. This one. Again, this is a video on groups. It is still in our Skype chat. You can still view them by playing back like what I'm doing here. But the one I actually want is the groups illustrations, which is this video here. Right? So I have already resourced you now with all the videos. You now have all the videos here. I'm sending them in our class WhatsApp group. So you can now play these. In addition to this, I'm always on the lookout for questions for you guys. I'm always on the lookout. Now let me open today's question paper, which is about CP group. And CP group, so it should be now SBR. Zippo, sorry. Where's the question? Yeah. Right, so this is Zippo question. Okay. So because of time, I'm going to read the question myself. I'm going to read the question myself here. Let me zoom it out. So dedicate today and tomorrow for groups. Just dedicate it. Play the videos I have sent. And all these videos are on my Facebook timelines. So even if you just scroll, but you know, some are around early March, mid-March, so we have a lot of scrolling back to do. No wonder why I avoided that by sending you the videos. Plus, you may not know which one is ideal, which one is not, because there's a myriad of videos on my timeline. Now, allow me to read Zippo question. It says, Zippo is a parent company that operates in the manufacturing sector. It has several subsidiaries and also has a wide portfolio of investment properties. The current financial year end is 30 June 2008. Acquisition of Billy. On 1 September 2005, Zippo acquired 60% of the equity interest in Billy, measuring the non-controlling interest as a proportion of net assets. You know, when they are saying non-controlling interests were measured as a proportion of net assets, they're actually saying it was a partial goodwill method. A partial goodwill method was used to calculate NCI. The purchase consideration comprised of cash of 90 million payable immediately and a further 10 million payable at 31 August 2007 if certain growth targets were met. The fair value of this consideration was determined to be 7.5 million at acquisition date, and this had increased to 8 million by 30 June 2006 and 9.5 million by 30 June 2007, and due to favorable trends in the post-acquisition growth. The full amount was paid on 31 August 2007 as growth targets were met. Zippo also paid 600,000 to professional advisors and lawyers in relation to the acquisition in the year end 30 June 2006. The carrying amount of the recognized net assets of Billy at 1 June 2005. Remember, 1 June 2005, we acquired it on 1 September. So we acquired it during the year. So the carrying amount of recognized net assets at 1 June 2005 was 115 million. and this was equal to the fair value. Billy also had an recognized customer-based intangible assets at this date, and a provisional provisional fair value of 21 million was attributed to Zippo. Was attributed to this. Zippo engaged third-party experts to measure the fair value of these assets, and they completed their work on 31 July 2006, concluding that the fair value of the intangible assets were actually 20 million. So they had said it's 21, but after undertaking due diligence, it was 20 million. Now, disposal of interest in Billy. Zippo disposed of 20% interest in Billy on 30 March 2008 for cash consideration of 44 million. The remaining 40% had a fair value of 90 million, and Zippo exercised significant influence over Billy following the disposal. Zippo accounts for investment in subsidiaries at a cost in its separate financial statements. And has included a gain on disposal of 11 million in the profit or loss. The net assets of Billy at 31 March 2008 had a carrying amount of 133 million in its separate financial statements. At this date, goodwill recognized that acquisition was unimpaired. The customer-based intangible assets had been impaired by 20% in January 2008. Right? In the year ended 30 June 2008, Billy reported a profit for the year of 8 million and recognized other comprehensive income of 3.6 million. Both were deemed to accrue evenly throughout the year. So, notice disposal was on 31 March 2008 and the year end is 30 March 2008. So we disposed mid of the year. So there were certain period where it was a subsidiary, and now for the rest of the 3 months it was no longer a subsidiary. So there you go. Planned investments in cheaper. The directors of Zippo are considering the purchase of equity shares in another company, cheaper. Rather than buying a controlling interest, they are likely looking to buy a 5% shareholding and then increase it. They are initially looking to buy a 5% shareholding and then increase it by a further 20%. At this stage, they would expect to have board membership of cheaper and be sharing technical information. If this shareholding is successful, Zippo will then buy a further 50% to gain control of cheaper. Preparation of consolidated financial statements. A new member of Zippo's board of directors suggested that there's no need for the company to prepare consolidated financial statements, and that the process for preparing them is unnecessary and time-consuming and costly. Now, draft explanatory notes to the directors of Zippo addressing the following issues: a calculation of goodwill on acquisition of Billy and an explanation of the amounts recognized in profit or loss as a result of the acquisition. And then an explanation of the difference between accounting treatment of each of the following in the separate and consolidated financial statements of Zippo for the years ended 30 June 2008, a disposal of 20% interest, equity interest in Billy, and retained 40% interest in Billy. Then 3C, how the various shareholdings in cheaper should be accounted for in both Zippo's separate financial statements and in the consolidated financial statements. A discussion of the board member's suggestion, 30 marks. So these are normally your typical number one questions. So we want to answer them one by one, but today I want to show you again how we answer these. I know I've showed you that. And as you say, I need not to tire and just, just say, because I've showed you this before, so I can't share with you again. I need to do this over and over until it rings bell. Until it's now off the top of your head. You have to have it off the top of your head. Meaning it should come. So for the purpose of illustrating this question, I shall not be opening a word processor, and I can't be opening word processor and at the same time opening the Excel. I will be doing all my typing on Excel. But everything that I'm typing on Excel, in your exam, you choose the word processor response options. Remember, there are two response options. There's word processor, and then there is spreadsheet. I shall pivot my attention to address that. I shall actually, after we have done this, we shall open your question on CBE practice platform, just to let you know what I'm talking about. So, actually, you open your word processor and you write Zippo group. Because this is about Zippo. So this is Zippo group of companies. So it's not saying prepare a report. It's simply saying prepare explanatory notes to directors of Zippo. So all you simply do is explanatory notes to directors of Zippo. Explanatory notes to directors of Zippo. Remember, where you are typing this, it's in the word processor, not on Excel, not on the spreadsheet. But I'm just using the spreadsheet because I don't want to have a lot of folders or interfaces open on my desktop. But in your, I shall show you this shortly. So you then have to go one by one. A calculation of goodwill on acquisition of Billy, right? And amounts recognized. A calculation of goodwill on acquisition of Billy and explanation. Now, under normal circumstances, you just copy this explanation of amounts recognized in P&L. What you do in the exam, what I advise you to do is, I advise you to just do this. To just copy, otherwise you will not finish. Because when you are typing it, like, oh, this time I have got copy restrictions in this paper. These are papers we got from elsewhere. So because there are restrictions, I can't copy. Now in your exam, you don't need to retype the question. You not finish. All you do is you copy everything as it is here. Copy to the end. And then just put your case away you are writing and begin to write. Move on to the next, begin to write. So after you have copied everything, you notice you can start by writing on B. Put your case on A, come back to A, put your case on D. If you feel like easy marks are obtained on that particular part of the question, just start by attacking that. Right. So what you then do is, after doing this I would have copied and pasted, not necessarily typing. Now, I come back to the question. You do notice that Billy, Zippo acquired Billy like this. Zippo acquired Billy, 60% of Billy, measuring non-controlling interest in proportion to the net assets. That was on 1 September, right? And if you realize clearly, the purchase consideration was 90 million, and a further 10 million was payable on 31 August. If you hear this word, if, it means it is a contingent consideration, meaning it's a 10 million will be paid upon a condition is met. In this case, there were growth targets that were supposed to be met. Now, the fair value of the consideration was determined to be as 7.5 million. So there you go. It was determined to be 7.5 million. So though you pay it as 10 million, you pay it in August 2007. Remember, you've acquired in September 2005. So you pay this in August 2007. So you pay them, there's 20x6 and 20x7. So you are going to pay this. There's 20x6, 20x7. So you are going to pay this 2 years later. But when you are calculating goodwill, you recognize this at fair value. So you recognize this at 7 million. Now, because it's a payment that you are going to make, it is called a contingent consideration. And in this case, it's actually a liability because you are undertaking to pay this later if the targets are met. Now, if your liability, which is this contingent, increases to 8 million, it means the difference goes to profit or loss. You get that? If it increases from 8 million to 9.5 million, again, the other 0.5 goes to profit or loss because it's a liability which is increasing. And by 30 June 2007, it was paid in full, meaning it was paid as 10 million. So there's a further increase of from there was increase of 8 to 9.5, which is 1.5, and a further increase from 9.5 to 10. All these incremental are expenses to profit or loss. Now, we are told that Zippy paid also what? Zippo paid 600,000 for professional fees. You know, legal fees paid does not form part of consideration transferred. This is actual because if you pay lawyers to acquire a company or maybe to when you are negotiating the terms and conditions of the acquisition, the amount that you pay to your attorneys is not part of the consideration transferred. So that one we don't need to bother ourselves much about that. The carrying amount of the net assets at 30 June was 115. At 1 June. Oh, sorry. So this was a typing error. They actually wanted to say 1 September here because there's no other date which is 1 June elsewhere. So that one was a typing error. In exams, you don't get such typing errors anyway. These are like mock exams, mock questions that we are getting for you. So perhaps those will. Are you not seeing it? They wanted to say carrying amount at acquisition, which is 1 September, but they typed it as 1 June. So for the purpose of reading, it's 1 September 2005. The carrying amount was 115. Billy also had unrecognized the customer based intangible assets. So we are also told that the fair value of assets was 115, but 115 exclude fair value adjustment. Fair value adjustment was 21 million. Now, 21 million was about customer based intangible assets. But you'd notice that in the videos that I have sent in our WhatsApp class group, where I said you should play these videos on groups, I emphasized that there is what is called measurement period. Do we still have anyone who remembers what that period is? And can you unmute and explain such period to yourself? What do you understand by measurement period? Can you explain it to yourself? Unmute and explain it to yourself if you can. Right. Oh, guys, talk to yourself. You can't tell me that you have all forgotten measurement period. Otherwise, I will ask you to play the videos and then we don't proceed with this one. What is it that I said is the measurement period? You need to try. Yes, with that. Yes, RIU Rumbi, I suppose. You can unmute and go ahead.
Okay, let me. I want to attempt. We said the measurement period is the
Yes.
period that is admissible after the acquisition date for the acquirer to do their own due diligence on the fair values to sort of confirm if they were correct in about
Yes.
12 months or so.
Yes, you are correct. I actually I freeze three. sets a measurement period of 12 months maximum. It's a measurement period of up to 12 months. Within the measurement period, the acquirer can actually assess how reasonable are the way the assumptions used in coming up with fair values, and even carry out due diligence to obtain the true fair values. If new information is obtained during the measurement period, we retrospectively adjust our goodwill estimate with that new information, and that is called measurement period adjustments. So this is why you are given this particular statement here, which is saying the fair value was provisional at 21. So we provisionally said customer based intangible assets is a fair value of 21, and then as period during the measurement period, because we acquired on 1 September and we got new information on 31 July 2006. So you can tell it is still within the measurement period. It concluded that the fair value was actually 20 instead of 21. So this is where the information is. And we are being asked to prepare explanatory notes to the directors of CP. So I want to take the burden of typing, because I want you to follow this approach going forward. So this was A. So you actually write it nicely. You say A, and then you say IFRS 3 business combination. IFRS 3. Each time you cite a standard for the first time, you tell us what the standard is all about. So you say business, because you are advising directors. You need to tell us what is your authority. Business combinations requires the acquirer to compute goodwill upon obtaining control. Goodwill upon obtaining control. Notice, because the question is saying prepare explanatory notes for the calculation of goodwill. It's not saying just calculate goodwill. Tell examiners how goodwill is calculated. That's what it means when they say explanatory notes for the calculation, for a calculation of goodwill. Don't just rush calculate it, but explain its calculation. That's what it means. So you say goodwill, this is calculated as, this is calculated as the difference, you know, we are telling the examiner how goodwill is calculated, difference between the sum of consideration transferred, I'm doing the typing so that I challenge you also to type, sum of consideration transferred plus value of NCI less fair value of subsidiaries identifiable net assets. Fair value of subsidiaries identifiable net assets. What else do you see? And say contingent consideration of 10 million, contingent consideration of 10 million is recognized at its value of 7.5 million at acquisition date. Subsequent changes in fair value in fair value are recognized as expenses in profit or loss, are recognized as expenses in or loss. I'm so shortening piece that we don't want that you write in full. But if you are really under time pressure, examiners may actually know what you are referring to as P/L, but don't take chances. Then you say costs, legal costs incurred to acquire a subsidiary, legal costs incurred to acquire a subsidiary are expensed to profit or loss. You don't consider them as part of consideration transferred. No, they are expensed to profit or loss. You get that? All right. You can skip a line and say IFRS 3. Now this time you don't now say business combination, because you have already said in a reference to the standard already. So you can say IFRS 3 also sets a measurement period of 12 months, of up to 12 months from acquisition date. Within this period, comma, Zippo as the acquirer can assess the reasonability of assumptions, in other words, due diligence, close bracket, used to determine fair values at acquisition date, the fair values at acquisition date. Are you not seeing I am typing and applying at the same time? Then I say thus, comma, Zippo. Before I say thus, I say if new information is obtained during this period, comma, Zippo may retrospectively. Oh, if new information is obtained during this period, as is the case with customer-based intangible assets. Notice I am citing the standard and applying it right away. If new information is obtained during this period, as is the case with customer-based intangible assets, comma, Zippo needs to retrospectively adjust the goodwill estimated at acquisition. Estimated at acquisition. So there you go. So Zippo needs to retrospectively adjust the goodwill estimated at acquisition. Thus, the provision of goodwill is calculated. The goodwill is initially calculated using good. Thus, goodwill calculated using in the fair value of net assets. Oh well, it appears I typed continuously. All right, so let me, you know, the danger was I was thinking I'm typing on Word. Let me there, paste it here, and then again, yes, it's the case with simple. Let me cut it there, paste it here. The thus kudu is okay. It was like I was being misled, thinking that I'm typing on Word. So thus goodwill is initially calculated using fair value of net assets of, so fair value of net assets initially is, you come here and pick, remember it, that's what they mean by explanatory notes, first explain. So fair value of net assets initially is 115 plus 21 plus 21, which is what is the figure? 115 plus 21, you say 115 plus 21, which is 136. With final goodwill computation using assets of it's a final goodwill, it will be 115 plus 20, which is 115 plus 20, which is equals to 135 million. Then what, having done that, you are done. You then say calculation of goodwill. So you now have a calculation of goodwill. Now this goodwill, so notice this, you would have done this in the spreadsheet. So you then say computations in working one. So you are now linking shows an initial goodwill of and a final goodwill of. Notice I haven't calculated yet. I will just go to the Excel and calculate, and then come to punch in the figures there. Also, full stop. Also, amounts recognized to profit or loss. Amounts recognized to profit or loss. As a result. Acquisition are as follows. Now everything that I'm writing here, I have already explained it at the top. That changes in. So there are various years that we are given. So you have got year end 30 June. So these are your various year ends. 30 June, Where are you typing this? Word processor, 30 June, X, the first one is X6, 30 June, X. We acquired 1 September, so the year end is 30. Is it? Is the year end is what? What are the year ends here? 30 June, X6, 30 June, X7, yes. So it's 30 June, X6, then 20 X7, and again 20 X7. Because, yeah, 20X7, that's when we were going to make this contingent consideration. It was payable, or this one was payable in 31 August 20X7. So this year is now 20X8, because it will end 30 June 20X8. Now, you say legal costs. I said legal costs are expensed to profit or loss. Legal costs. Cost of 600,000. What else is expensed to profit or loss? The contingent consideration increased this year from acquisition of fair value 7.5 to 8. So you say increase in fair value of CC, increase in fair value of as contingent consideration. In this first year, it increased by 500, 1, 2, 3, meaning from 7.5 to 8. And then in second year, from 8 to 9.5, which is 1,500,000. And then in the final year, it was now paid in full. They are saying the full amount was paid. By full amount, they are saying the 10 million. So it increased from 9.5 to 10 million. By 500,000. Are you not seeing something? Please pay attention. Are you not seeing something? Even if the examiner says time up, out of these allocated 8 marks, I may just lose only 2. Out of 8, I can just lose only 2, even if I'm yet to calculate goodwill. The reason is because I have already explained it. The examiner already knows. Even if I then go to make an error in calculation, the examiner may then say because it was perhaps exam pressure or something. But the student knows. Are you not seeing I have actually explained to the examiner that I know how good is calculated. So suppose in the spreadsheet now, so this is now in the, remember I said computations in working one. So this is how you show your workings. You link your workings in the spreadsheet to your word processor. Everything is typed here in the word processor. So you now say workings. This is now spreadsheet. You say workings. Examiner can see, just say Zippo group. So that examiner can actually follow through. Which workings are you referring to? So we have got working one, goodwill. Goodwill calculation. So easy. So the net assets are going to change. So if net assets are changing, it means NCI will be changing. So we do have a draft goodwill. Or if we don't want to use the word draft, we can say provisional goodwill. So this is provisional. Oh, so let me type here. Provisional goodwill. And then we have the final goodwill. Yes, final goodwill. Final goodwill. No, why is so? Because NCI will be affected by fair value measurements. Final goodwill. So we have to do two workings because when fair value changes, the share attributable to NCI changes. So you say consideration transferred. And now there is cash. You know, we do have cash. How much cash was paid? You come to this question. Consideration transferred. There was cash of 90. And contingent consideration of 7.5. I told you we take the fair value, not the full amount. So there was cash 90 million, and then you get you can You can put these figures as thousands. You can put these figures as thousands to say 90,000. Okay, let me. Actually, that one is an important thing, so that you know, though you can put them as millions, but it would make sense to me if you put them as thousands like this, like that one. So that if I say copy and say do it like this to make sense. So instead of 90 million, I say 90,123, and then I say fair value of CC, fair value of CC, fair value of contingent consideration, 7,500. There also I can just copy this to say equals. So that I can just drag here on the go. All right. Then what do you do here? You say value of NCI, value of NCI. Now the group uses partial goodwill method. Now if it's using partial goodwill method, it means NCI is a proportion of net assets. So before you calculate NCI here, you need to find net assets. So you then say net assets. So net assets, you do have 115. You also have 115 here. What else do you have? You have got fair value adjustments, FVA. It was initially 21. It's now 20. The examiner wants to see this. And then, after doing this, you can now have your goodwill. So, because you know, notice the NCI line is still blank. So equals minus sum. The NCI line is still blank because it's partial goodwill method, meaning I first get net assets first, and NCI is a proportion of net assets. So if NCI is a proportion of net assets, then where I've said value of NCI, I then say open bracket. Remember, we acquired 60%, so NCI is 40%. So I say 40% times first times 136, second times 135. I can just show it like this. The examiner will know what I'm talking about, what I'm doing. So here it will be equals to 0.4 multiplied by 136. So there you go. So here it will be equals to 0.4 multiplied by 135. All right, 54,454, and then goodwill. If I add this, I get my goodwill. So here, I should put 136,000. I should put the figures as thousands. It's still fine. I should put the fee instead of saying one. My fair values of net assets. Remember I said my figures are in thousands, so here it should be 115,000. I should put three zeros. Here it should be 21,000, like this. Here in the same vein it should be 115,000, and here it should be 20,123. So I now have my goodwill, my goodwills. So these are my goodwill computations. So initially, goodwill is 15.9, and subsequently, so this is goodwill. Now, you may be given something by the examiner. The examiner may say, the fair value adjustment or the measurement period adjustment doesn't affect NCI. It means the value of NCI will remain the same, but net assets will change. Normally, that statement, you see it when it's partial goodwill method. So I now come to my word processor here and then just type the goodwills. It's a matter of coming here and then type 15,900, 15.9 million, and the other one 16.5 million. 16.5 5 million. So I'm done with the question. That's where my 8 marks are. From today, follow this. Never do anything to whatever you'll be listening, even if you play a video or what, when they don't do it this way, ignore them. You know, why we ask you to ignore them is, you know, Atlant Resources, as Atlant Resources, we do have the highest pass rate in this particular subject. So when I'm asking you to say, do this, just do this, do it at face value. Don't worry about anything else. You are being told what makes you pass. Okay, so there you go. Then continuing. So I then I'm continuing this question with this. It then says, explanation of the difference between accounting treatment of each of the following in the separate and consolidated financial statements. 20% disposal of interest in Billy. So remember, there are 12 marks allocated. Meaning, if you are explaining 20% disposal of interest in Billy, you need to know this. They want you to explain how it is treated in the separate accounts and how it is treated in the consolidated accounts, financial statements. Again, when you are now explaining retained earning, retained 40% retained interest in Billy, you again need to explain how this is treated in the separate financial statements and how this is treated in the consolidated. Now, I need to tell you what they mean by separate. Separate meaning individual accounts. Individual accounts of Zippo. Before we consolidate, remember when you are consolidating, you are bringing the accounts of Zippo and the accounts of Billy. Before they are merged, they are called separate financial statements. And the way we treat in separate financial statements normally differs from the way we treat in consolidated financial statements. So this question needs to be carefully answered. And remember, today I did send you stuff where I actually told you that there is need to be conscious in your answering. I gave you the guidelines. And amongst the guidelines, which was key number 4 here, I say structure your answer and where appropriate, put subheadings. Make sure this is point taken. Try to work on every key there as you practice your final lap, as you are in the final lap of your revision. So we do have 20%. So you write B1. You write B first, B1. Disposal of 20% interest in Billy. Disposal of 20% interest in Billy. Now, the question actually says how it is accounted in separate and in consolidated. So put subheadings so that the examiner can follow where actually, which part of the question are you addressing? You say accounting in the separate, accounting treatment, accounting treatment in separate financial statements. Remember, all this in Billy. I said whenever it is written elsewhere, it's a matter of copy. So I am still the disposal of 20%, I must state how it is accounted for in separate financial statements and how it is accounted for in consolidated. So I then do it like this. I then say a Zippo must compute and recognize. Recognize gain or loss in its separate financial statements. It is calculated as follows. It is calculated as the difference between consideration received. This time it's consideration received because we are selling. Consideration received less the carrying value of the investment disposed. Carrying value of the investment disposed. Now you can say that is, it's not every working should be done on the word, on the spreadsheet. Some simple workings can be done right away, like that is consideration received. How much did we receive when we disposed our interest, our 20% interest in Billy? Here we received the cash of 44 million. So consideration received, you can put here thousands. It was 44,000. And then you say less carrying value of investment disposed. Now this one, you notice if we are told that Zippo accounts for its investment in subsidiaries at cost. So we need to understand what was the cost. Cost is the amount which Zippo paid, which is 90 million plus 7.5. This was the cost which Zippo records in its books. So you remember we said the changes in fair value it just goes to profit or loss. It doesn't affect goodwill calculation. In goodwill, you just use contingent consideration at acquisition. When it then changes, any change just goes to profit or loss. We don't review our goodwill with those changes. So the cost is 97.5. So cost of investment disposed. Remember, for 97.5, this was equal to 60%. This was 60. 60 we paid 97.5 and we disposed 20. So you simply say 20 over 60, not 20% of 100. No, investment was for 60% and we disposed 20%. So you say if 60 was 97.5, what was 20%? That is the carrying value. So it's 20% over 60% times 97,500, like this. And then you say equals minus 20 over 60 times 97,500. So this is gain in the separate financial statements. This is the gain which Zippo must account in its separate financial statements. So this is gain. And remember, this gain is not consolidated. This gain is not consolidated. You get that? This one is not consolidated. So what about, because there was this disposal, they wanted how it is treated in separate and how it is treated in the consolidated. So you then say accounting treatment in consolidated financial statements. Accounting treatment in consolidated financial. Now, how do we account in consolidated? You are proceeding with your explanation. Then you'd say, the disposal of 20% interest in Billy resulted in Zippo losing control. Therefore, Zippo must compute group gain or loss on disposal. Zippo must compute group gain or loss on disposal. Group gain or loss on disposal. Group gain or loss on disposal. Also, comma, goodwill. Recognized when control is lost. Derecognized. Disposed when control is lost. When control is lost. When control is lost. Alright. So this is computed as follows. The gain or loss, the group gain or loss is computed as follows. Gain or loss is computed as follows. Notice by putting sub paragraphs, I'm making it clear to the examiner that I don't want to lose marks. So here's how we compute group gain or loss. Please, if any concept I'm explaining here, you don't understand why you need further explanations on this, please play this video, which I have sent. Where is it? This one. Play this video here, which I have sent here. These videos on groups, especially this one. Especially, this is where everything is explained. Notice group disposals, etc. Every concept I'm putting across here, I'm actually taking it from that. So you then say consideration received. Now consideration received, you say forty-four thousand. Then you say value of remaining interest. Fair value of remaining interest. Now, the fair value of remaining interest will be given by the examiner that, remember, we had 60, so we lost 20, so we are left with 40. We disposed 20. We are left with 40. And the 40 is a fair value of 90 million. So you just put 90,000 here. And then you then say net assets at the date of disposal. Net assets at date of disposal. Now the date of disposal is 31 March. So you can simply say net assets at 31 March. X8. So there are a lot of net assets at 31 March X8. We are told that you are actually noticing that they are saying Zippo accounts for investment in subsidiary at cost in its separate financial statements and has included a gain of 11.5 million in profit or loss. So this gain was correctly calculated. Are you noticing here? We calculated it as 11.5, so it was correctly calculated. So you can comment here that the gain was correctly calculated and accounted for. The net assets of Billy at 31 March had a carrying amount of 133 million in separate financial statements. So the net assets of Billy, so we are saying they had a carrying amount of 133. So there was 133 million. Well, now when they say in Billy's separate financial statements, when we have this statement here that they had a carrying amount of in separate financial statements, what that statement means is separate financial statements of a subsidiary, they don't include goodwill, number one. They don't include fair value adjustments, number two. So in other words, there's then need for us to say add fair value adjustments fair value adjustments. And in this case, the fair value adjustment we are talking about is the customer base intangible asset. And they are saying it was impaired by 20% in January 2008. So it's not, we found it was 20 million when we calculated goodwill here, which was the final, and then it was impaired by 20%, meaning when we are now putting it at the date of disposal, it's no longer 20 million, but rather it's now 80%, because it was impaired by 20%. So it's now 80% times 20 million, and you get 16,000. Right, so these are the carrying amounts of net assets, and then you say so what you can add here to get a subtotal. You can add this part to get a subtotal, and I told you what to do. You then say less NCI in net assets, NCI in net assets. So NCI in net assets is 40%. Remember, NCI was 40% times 149 million. 149 million here. So you say equals minus 0.4 times this figure here. And then you say goodwill disposed. Goodwill disposed. Why this good? We are disposing goodwill because we check, was it impaired? They say goodwill recognized that acquisition was unimpaired. If it was impaired somehow during the period, we put the balance. We put the balance. But in this case, we are told that whatever we calculated at acquisition, which was the final goodwill year, 16.5, it's still 16.5 here, 16,500. So what we then do is, remember, you're calculating group gain or loss on disposal. So you then say equals sum. Like this, close 105,900. I explained all these in the videos. It's you are well taken care of. Only if you can just play those videos that we have calculated. So this is group gain on disposal. Group gain on disposal. Now this group gain, this is the group gain on disposal. You notice the group gain on disposal. Of course, some may analyze it into realized gain and unrealized gain, which is still, which is to an extent still correct, because you dispose, you may analyze this group gain on disposal, the gain, you can analyze it as what gain was realized, what gain was unrealized. So you can that analysis is no longer, is not necessarily relevant, but it's, you may put it, but it's not really relevant. So how do you analyze it? Suppose you want to analyze it, you can put here realized gain, realized gain, and then unrealized gain, unrealized. Why some is realized, some is unrealized? It's because we disposed and we remained with 40. We disposed and we remained with 40. So it would be a matter of saying, what we put here as what we have realized of the cost of the investment that we have. Notice the investment disposed. You say carrying value of investment, carrying value of investment. Now, if we do have, let us say carrying value of investment, only realized, we realized 20 over 60 multiplied by 97,500. Remember, I told you that. So we realized, equals 20, we have calculated it already. It's here, it's here. And then, you know, unrealized. For the 40% which is left, we are told that 40% has got investment of 90 million. Or we can put it like the investment we have here is 40 over 60. 40 over 60 multiply by 97,500. You can analyze it like this, but this analysis is not necessarily very much. 40 over 60 multiplied by 97,500. So you can now use these ratios. You can now use these ratios to break down this goodwill. You can now use this ratio to break to apportion. Now you can then apportion the gain. Apportion the gain. You can now apportion this gain using the to say this one equals 32,500 divided by 97,500 multiplied by the gain. So we have realized this gain. You can put it that, and then we can say unrealized equals the same to say this over 97,500 multiplied by the gain. Alright, so there you go. So you may say here is 9, but in separate financial statements they realized 11.5. Again, you can further analyze and break down the difference, but this part is not part of the question. Once you calculate group gain or loss on disposal, which is 28,1, you can move on. This part is really not that much necessary. So, okay, are you not seeing we are doing it step by step? We have taken the first part here, which was 20, because there are 12 marks allocated. 20% at disposal of 20% equity interest in Billy. We now want retained 40% interest in Billy. We also want to analyze it into two parts. So this is B2. You say B2. Retained 40% interest in Billy. Now the retained 40% interest in Billy, we are told that Billy had significant influence, you know, after it retained this, they are saying it Zippo exercised significant influence. So it is accounted for as an associate in the consolidated statement of financial position, or it is equity accounted. So what you do is you say accounting treatment in Billy's separate financial statements. Accounting treatment. Accounting treatment in this separate financial statements. Financial statements. How do we account for this? How do we account for this particular remaining interest? So you say the remaining interest has significant influence on or confers significant influence over Billy, meaning Zippo has significant influence over Billy, comma, Zippo should therefore account for it as an associate. Zippo should therefore account as an associate. associate. You know, Zippo should therefore account for it as an associate. Now, since Zippo accounts for its investment in subsidiaries, investment in subsidiaries at cost, in subsidiaries at cost. You know, today's lecture, I said I want to type, so bear with me, because I want to show you how you'll be doing it. And if you can see yourself doing it, you don't have an excuse of saying, oh, say, you need to also to be doing it. Since Zippo account for its investment in subsidiaries at cost, can be accounted at any of the following amounts in separate financial statements. You know, in separate financial statements, you can account for any of the following amounts. You can account for it using cost, because I told that Billy accounts for its investment in subsidiaries at cost. So if the remaining 40% can be recorded at cost. Simple. So it will be 40/60. Remember, it had 60% multiplied by the total cost was 97,500. So the possible figure there, it may be cost 40/60 multiplied by 97,500. This is the most common one. We can just account for it at 65. That's the cost of the remaining interest. Or you can even account it at consider fair value at disposal as cost. You know, if you dispose your interest in Billy 20% and you are told that the remaining had a fair value of 40, you can consider this to be cost. So in this case you can record it at 90 million. These are the possible valuations that you can have. Or you can record it as equity accounted value. Accounting, right? Equity accounting. Let's see below. You can do equity accounting now. But when you are doing equity accounting, you then need it is normally consistent with accounting treatment in group's statement of financial position. And in consolidated financial statements. Now, in the consolidated financial statements, there are various ways you need to equity account the associate. So you simply say the investment in associate is equity accounted. The standard requires it to be equity accounted. This means that the associate is initially recognized at cost. Recognized at cost, which is the fair value of remaining interest which is the fair value of remaining interest. At each reporting date, comma, the investment is adjusted with Zippo's share of profit of post acquisition or losses, as well as acquisition OCI, share of post acquisition OCI. Dividend received is net dividend received from the share of dividend received and dividend received from the associate is deducted. The associate is periodically tested for impairment in accordance IAS impairment of assets. So there you are. So then you say carrying amount of K. So you say equity accounted carrying amount. Now if you want to calculate equity accounted carrying amount, you then say fair value of remaining interest. Remember, this is like cost of the associate. This is cost of the associate, which is 90 million. And then you say add share of post acquisition profit or loss. Now you are told that after we had, you know, remember our year end is 30 June, but we disposed on 31 March, meaning for April, May and June that it was an associate for 3 months. So for this 8 million recognized, they are saying profit for the year was 8 million. But for 3 months, when it was an associate, we only take our share. So it would be like our share is 40% of the profit of 8 million. Profit is 8 million, but it was an associate only for 3 months. So you say times 3 over 12. That is post-acquisition. Then again, there's share of OCI. OCI for the year was 3.6, and it was an associate for 3 months. So our share, yes.
Was it for 3 months or for 9 months?
No, we disposed on 31 March. So it was a subsidiary for 9 months, but it was an associate for 3 months.
Okay.
Yes. The question is, the examiner wants to know how you are to treat the remaining 40%, meaning the examiner is interested with the 3 months when it was now an associate. So you then say 40% multiplied by 3.6 million multiplied by 3 over 12. Not if you can only be this smart in an exam, You can actually score all the marks, Rijo. Rijo, are you in the lecture? Rejoice. Do we have Rejoice in the lecture? 0.4 times 8, 1, 2, 3, times 12 equals 0.4 times 3, 600 times 3 over 12. Okay, so the equity accounted value for the associate, if you go by, if it will be 9,116. So this will be the can, this will be in the consolidated statement of financial position. So this organized, as investment in associate in the consolidated statement of financial position. Now, what you are asking is so important. It's like the examiner might actually have asked the how. If the examiner is not specifically said, the remaining, and the examiner has just said how you will account for the disposal of 20%. If the question was that blunt and loaded with 12 marks, again, if they say how you account for the disposal of 20% and they put 12 marks, still, this is how you were going to answer it. Even if they just said 20%, you were going to say the 20% disposed first, treatment in separate financial statements, treatment in consolidated, and then the remaining interest, treatment in financial statements, treatment in consolidated. But you would then say, we consolidate Billy as a subsidiary for 9 months. Are we together? So you would then, this is not part of this answer, so allow me to, again, I will shed it shortly. You'd say, we consolidate Billy as a subsidiary for 9 months, up to 31 March X8. So what does it mean? It means in consolidated statement of profit or loss and OCI, we time apportion revenue and expense. We time apportion revenue and expense items. Apportion the revenue and expense items, but this part, so in this part was not asked, but this was the central part to your question when you said 9 months. But in the consolidated statement of financial position, all we do is we recognize investment in associate. This was part of it, this was required, but this one wasn't. Okay. Can you imagine? Already you've got 20. Remember, it's only out of 30. This is what your CS students do. They harvest marks. Now, how do you harvest marks? If you come to the guide here, which is this, you harvest marks by going for the easy marks. Now, in this question, easy marks are on calculation of goodwill. Surely you can't say you are having issues. Calculation of goodwill is very easy. And you also go for easy marks where? You go for easy marks when you stick to the facts given in the scenario. Don't try to wander around just explaining the standard without even relating it to the scenario. It doesn't carry you any marks. Notice I was avoiding a situation where I explained the standard outside the context of what I'm given for ZP. So it's so important. It's so important. And sorry, I'm opening quite a lot. You know, it appears I caught flu. I was sneezing like nobody's business. But don't worry, it's not COVID. You have your cell with you. So there's no need to panic. Now, how the various shareholdings in CHIPA should be accounted for in both ZP's separate financial statements and in consolidated. You know, today it appears they need this question. Separate. And, you know, don't let the examiner actually specify that separate and consolidated. You know, when it comes to group issues, accounting treatments are in either separate or group. Unless the examiner has specifically said group, that's where you leave out the separate financial statement part. But if the examiner just say advise directors on the correct accounting treatment, clearly that question is saying in their separate financial statements and in groups. Now, normally students lose marks now because they are super efficient when they know the accounting treatment in groups, but hardly relate to separate financial statements. So it's investments in CHIPA. Investments in CHIPA. Now, this is it's investments or shareholdings in CHIPA. It's like shareholdings in CHIPA. Investments or shareholdings in CHIPA. Oh, sorry, I've already said in CHIPA part of it. So this is part C of the question. Part C of the question. So I'm trying by all means to teach you groups. I don't think I will be teaching groups in the next lecture. I want to concentrate on standards, and so forth. So I won't be like focusing on groups. I will be focusing on standards. So if you play this today's video and the class videos, you know, those we did whilst you are having lectures in class prior to revision, coupled with this one and your thorough exam practice, which is always ongoing, believe you me, we will actually put this exam snake online. Okay, so what our investments in CHIPA, you know, you need not to panic. You need to read the requirements of the question carefully. 7 marks are just obtained are coming from here because this is the issue concerning CHIPA. So allow me to read it. The directors of ZIPO are considering the purchase of equity shares in another company, CHIPA. Rather than buying a controlling interest, they are initially looking to buy a 5% shareholding and then increase that by a further 20%, meaning it will be 25 by then. At this stage, they would expect to have board membership of CHIPA and sharing technical information. If this shareholding is successful, ZIPO will then acquire further 50% to gain control. So they want you to break it down one by one like this. 5%, 5% investment in shares, 5% investment in CHIPA's shares. Now, this one is the first one. You put sub paragraphs. Don't lump things together. You lose marks. Don't lump things together. You stand to lose marks. Make sure you actually, if you know that there are 3 investments and there is 7 marks. So the examiner perhaps is allocating 2.5, 2.5, 2.5 on each. So 5%. Then increase by 20, then acquiring full control. So what you have to do is paragraph it nicely like this to say, this is accounted for. This is accounted for as investment in equity instruments, actually is financial assets. That's for investments in equity instruments or financial assets. Initially, it is recorded at cost equal to fair value in accordance with IFRS 9, you then say financial instrument. Each time you mention a standard for the first time, tell us what that standard is all about. But if you had forgotten that IFRS 9, the standard on financial instruments is IFRS 9, if you have forgotten that, don't even mention it. Because that is called, it will be vulgar. Can you imagine? You would say in accordance with IAS 16 PPE, or in accordance with IAS 16 financial instruments. That would be, can you imagine? It was better if you had actually not mentioned in accordance with. It was better that way, because the gravity of that mistake is now amplified beyond measure. It's like you are, that gravity amounts to, you know, what can I say? Charging, adding rent to sales, rent paid to sales, something like that. It's so severe in finance. If you are not sure which standard you are referring to, you would rather leave that standard out. Otherwise, why not creating a bad picture in the eyes of the examiner for yourself by not referencing the standard well? If you don't know it, leave it out and just continue to state the correct accounting treatment. You may be penalized half a mark also. It will not take you that deep. So in accordance with IFRS 9 financial instruments, full stop. Subsequently, in both separate and consolidated financial statements, Zippo may choose to continue recognizing at cost in accordance with this policy, recognizing it at cost in accordance with its policy. You remember, its accounting policy is to recognize investments at cost. So Zippo may still say, after it had paid for the 5 million, it may then just continue recognizing it at cost. However, consistent with provisions of IFRS 9, Zippo may account for investment as financial assets at fair value through profit or loss, or or through OCI if it makes an irrevocable election. If it makes an irrevocable election. You know, you can to account for the financial assets at fair value through profit or loss or through OCI should you make an election to recognize in OCI. Thus, at each reporting date, comma, the carrying amount fair value gains or losses recognized in profit or loss or OCI, because you can choose is it to profit or loss or OCI, but when it is to OCI, it's because if you have made an election, dividends received, have invested in shares, so dividends you receive also dividends received will be accounted for as investment income in profit or loss. Dividend just goes to profit or loss. Now notice you are just chasing 2 marks, so I haven't overdone it. Are you not seeing that if it's 5%, there's no need to say separate the accounting treatment in both separate and consolidated is the same. Now increase of 20% additional holding to 25%. Now if you increase 20%, well, you buy additional 20% to put the holding to 25%. So what it would mean is as Zippo will have board membership and share technical information cheaper. This evidences presence of significant influence. Full stop. Therefore, comma. In separate financial statements, comma. Zippo may still continue to record at cost, as per its policy. May continue to record at cost as per its policy. The cost being now because we have increased from 5 to 25, so the cost being purchase cost. Of five percent that we had, purchase cost of 5% plus cost of 20%. So that would be the cost. Now in the consolidated financial statements, comma. statement is equity accounted, right? So the investment will be equity accounted as detailed. It will be equity accounted as detailed in now because it's the same explanatory note. You are required even to say as detailed in B2, as detailed in B2. You may tell the examiner this. However, in this case, the cost investment. Associate, the cost of the investment in associate will be determined as follows. Now, if you are increasing your interest from 5% to 25%, if you are asked how much was your investment in interest, you say amount paid to acquire additional 20%. You put the answer here. You say XX. You'll be doing it in the exam. Plus fair value of 5% interest on debt of increase. So this will be the cost of the investment in associate. Now this is like a swap and top. It's like a swap and top transaction. Suppose I had a Samsung J7, I want another Samsung, whatever the S, I don't know, the better version of it, like S8. I had Samsung J7 and I need F8, S8. Now, if Samsung J7, it was my 5% investment. If I get to a mobile phone dealer, I would tell the mobile phone dealer and say, look, I have my Samsung J7, I need S8. The dealer will not ask me and say, how much did you pay for your J7? No. The dealer will simply say the fair value of your J7 is 200. Now, can you add additional 300 to get your S8? Are you getting? The dealer will not ask me how much I bought the J7. So this is the analog. If you are increasing your investment from a simple investment into becoming an associate. You know, I'm not overdoing it because I'm just chasing how many marks? 2 or 2.5. So it's a matter of telling the examiner that I know this stuff. Then, on obtaining control, how would you account? Because it's like we are accounting for this. In separate financial statements, in ZPOS separate financial statements, comma, the investment will be recorded at cost as per policy. The investment will be recorded at cost as per its accounting policy. So what then do you do? So payments for 5% plus payment for 20% plus payment for for the 50%. So that will be the cost, and then dividend received will be investment income. Dividends received will be investment income. And received will be investment income. Now, in the in consolidated financial statements, consolidated financial statements, what do you do now in consolidated financial statements? You know, we consolidate from the date of this of obtaining control. We consolidate date from date of obtaining control. Of obtaining control. So you consolidate from the date you obtain control. That's the first thing. And again, what else do you do? Calculate goodwill on the day control. Calculate goodwill on the date control. On the goodwill. On the date control. Control is obtained as follows. Now, this is called the step acquisition of subsidiaries. Now, if a subsidiary is acquired in stages, like you obtain control, but you are doing it in stages, goodwill is calculated as follows. You say amount paid to increase interest by 20%, amount paid by 50%, you know, because you were now at 25 and you increase interest by 50%, so we put that amount here. We say XXX, and then we say add fair value of the 25% interest on that date, meaning debt you purchase, add value of NCI, then you then say less fair value of net assets, net assets on the date we obtain control, right? So the answer that you get will be goodwill or bargain purchase. You know, it may be goodwill or bargain purchase. Goodwill, bargain purchase. So bargain purchase, that is if what you get is negative here. All right. So notice I've just a little enough for just around 2.5 marks. I'm not overdoing it on each. So I notice if the question had allocated, if the examiner had allocated 7 marks, and on each the examiner wanted separate and consolidated on each, I had to make sure I paragraph my work so that the examiner can follow. Also, it reduces the risk of me not getting full marks on points that I know, especially on the last point, which says, when you obtain control, what you do. But are you not seeing that when you obtain control for a subsidiary which is acquired in stages, are you not seeing that the calculation of goodwill is different? It's like a swap and top transaction. If it was an associate and you now want to have a subsidiary, it's like you have got a Mark II, a vehicle, a Toyota Mark II, and you now need a Mack or Mercedes Benz. If you had a Toyota Mark II, which is your associate, and you now need Mercedes Benz, which is a subsidiary, what you do is you take your Toyota Mark II to the car dealer. The car dealer will not ask you and say, how much did you buy your Toyota Mark II for? The car dealer will not ask such a question. The car dealer will simply say, your Mark II has a fair value of 6,200 US. And the Benz we have here is 40,000. So what you then have to do is pay cash, which is 40,000, because it says it's a swap and top, minus 6.2. Notice. So you pay cash 33,800, and then the fair value of your Mark II, 3.6.2, and the answer is the cost of your Benz. So if you ask, if we see you with a subsidiary and ask you, how much did you buy your Benz? Can you break it down for us? The Benz being the subsidiary, you would say, I had my Mark II, which is the associate, with a fair value of 6.2. And then I had to top up with 33.8, which is the amount paid to increase the interest by 50, the amount for the 50%. And then the total, which is 40, is the amount that I paid. So actually, pay attention to this part. What it means is, in your books, your Mark II has been sold. Remember, Mark II was actually your asset, meaning the associate was your asset. So in your books, you have sold it. So what you then have to do is, Zipo must also, you need to calculate gain or loss on disposal of that associate, or you need to calculate gain or loss on disposal of the Mark II. So this is the point. Because your Mark, if you make a swap and top transaction, it means the original asset was sold. Effectively, that's what it means. So Zipo must then compute gain or loss on derecognition of the associate. Derecognition of the associate. Because if you take your Mark II for swap and top, it's as good as you have sold it. So you have to calculate gain or loss on disposal. Gain or loss on derecognition of the associate as follows. If issues with this, I gave you videos to play. Every statement I'm saying here is in those videos. So you say fair value of 25%. Now the fair value, that's your Mark II, on at date of obtaining control. No, you'll be told by the car sale that your Mark II is so much. But remember, in your books, your Mark II has its own depreciated cost. In your books, this Mark II has a depreciated cost. Then you say less equity accounted carrying amount. In your books, you have got equity accounted carrying amount for this associate. Now, in your books, you have carrying amount. You not have the fair value, but carrying amount. So what you then have to do is, you then say gain or loss on derecognition of associate. Gain or loss on derecognition of associate. Now, this one is consolidated. This gain or loss is consolidated. It's actually consolidated. This is consolidated. You actually put it as other income in the consolidated statement of financial position. Actually, group gains or loss normally are recognized as other income. Now, when you are playing other videos, some they call it a step acquisition adjustment. A step acquisition adjustment. They don't recognize it. They don't use the term gain or loss. But because I have used the Mark II analog, I'm sure I have hammered the point home so that you can actually see that this is what we are saying. A discussion of the board member's suggestion. Now, there is a board. Let me put my cases on the board member's suggestion. This is the board member's suggestion. It's saying, a new board member of Zipo's board of directors has suggested that there is no need for the company to prepare consolidated financial statements, and that the process for preparing them is unnecessarily time-consuming and costly. Now, when you're answering such a question, it's like board member's suggestion, which is D. Board member's suggestion. Board member's suggestion on preparing consolidated financial statements. You can see that I'm not lazy. Can you imagine if I can type it? When I'm a teacher, I had a privilege of just saying without typing. It shows you how dear what I'm doing is. And let this change you from now on and actually develop that attitude. And notice how neatly my answers are. Because I am preparing explanatory notes to the board. Notice, all this is explanatory note to the board members. But of course, because I was just using a spreadsheet, some of the calculations like on Goodwill and stuff, I considered my spreadsheet to be word processor as well, just for clarity to you as students. In the actual exam, these calculations will be done on spreadsheet. No wonder why we say computations on workings one. The assumption is we were saying we took these workings to put them on spreadsheet as if this was a word processor. I'm sure you get you are getting me on that. So there's a board member we say, there's no need for you guys to prepare consolidated financial statements. It's time consuming and costly and it's unnecessary. Now, when you're answering such a question on this one, let me not type. Let me just say, when you're answering such a question where the board member is saying, there's no benefit in preparing consolidated financial statements. This question, it's a matter of bringing attention to the board member on the provisions of IFRS, which is business combination, and IFRS 10, which is consolidated financial statements. So the board member needs to be told that IFRS 3, it treats parent and subsidiaries as a single entity. They are treated as a single entity, meaning for information to be useful, the parent and its subsidiaries are treated as a single entity, and the parent must then consolidate for the accounts to represent a single entity. You tell that. And then you say these standards as well, they are exemptions to consolidation. It's not like the board member is entirely wrong. No. There are exemptions to consolidation, like if the parent is also a subsidiary of another company. If the parent is also a sub of another. If you are a parent and you are a subsidiary of another, you may not prepare consolidated financial statements. Or if the parent is unlisted, you can choose. You can imagine if the parent is unlisted or in the process of listing, Now, you then apply, remember, always apply. There is this point here, which is key number three, which says stick to the facts given in the scenario and application. Avoid too much speculation. So after you have had this, all you have to do is then to come to the scenario here. You come to the scenario and you stick to the information. Now the information here is Zippo is a parent that operates in manufacturing sector. It has several subsidiaries and a wide portfolio of investment properties. So in other words, here, we are not told that Zippo is in the process of listing. We are not told that Zippo is, we are not told that Zippo is a subsidiary of another company. So you tell the board member that exemptions do not apply to Zippo. Exemptions do not apply to Zippo. So it must consolidate financial statements, in line with the said standards. You know, because today I wanted us to do March-June 2019, and then upon investigation, I realized that this paper, I have a video for it. So I said play the video, but allow me to give you the main takeoffs. If I don't open it and show you, you may not play the video, thinking that it's less important. Yet I had chosen it, only that I found the video that it was about March-June. Yet I not found the video we are going to do it. So this is again a 30 mark question, but I'm now just concentrating on the required part. Notice, it's saying calculate goodwill if the group uses full goodwill method and if the group uses partial goodwill method. I explained that part well in that particular video. And then there's this part, the 11 mark question, it's weighty. Because if you say 7 plus 3, that's 10, plus 11, that's already 21. If you add this together, you'd notice that the 11 mark question is saying, calculate and discuss the calculation and allocation. So don't start by just calculating. You play the video, you'd notice I was doing it exactly the same way we have done that paper. I wanted us to do this exactly the same, but no, having noticed that I have a video, I know I have done exactly the same way I was going to do it. But the most important point I want to hammer down is how you allocate impairment loss to a cash generating unit. If the group uses partial goodwill method and if the group uses full goodwill method. You know, if the group uses partial goodwill method, I mean, suppose the group uses full goodwill method, it means NCI has a share of goodwill. If it's a full goodwill method, NCI is a share of goodwill. So it's an easy way of allocating impairment loss to a cash generating unit. All you do is first eliminate goodwill and then reduce the carrying amount in proportion, the remaining assets in proportion to their carrying amounts, or as per any given information by the examiner. But if the impairment loss is allocated to assets of a cash generating unit and the group uses partial goodwill method, you first need to gross up goodwill. Grossing up goodwill means you first need to calculate notional goodwill, and notional goodwill is not consolidated. So all this, I explained this in that particular video. I felt like just to show you. But because that was a revision video, we then proceeded even to answer all these questions. Number two, when you are playing that video and you are answering number two of this paper, which is stent, you'd notice I repeated what I said in our last week but one video, where I said famous number two approach to questions. And in that particular video, I told you that whenever you are answering number two, the examiner will give you the bias of the answer. You'll be told when you are playing this video, by bias of the answer, I'm saying when you are using your skepticism And applying the standard with a skeptical mindset as to whether these were treated fairly, you get the bias of the answer from the first, from the introduction. Like in this case, we are told that in addition to this, debt covenants limits and based on gearing are close to being breached, and the company is already approaching its overdraft limit. You are given this information by the examiner to know, to tell you that whatever directors are likely to do in these subsequent transactions, perhaps they are trying to mislead users of financial statements or to mislead covenant holders, because covenants, which they were given a target debt to equity ratio, we call that covenant. That covenant is about to be breached. So whatever they are going to do, chances are they are going to account for these transactions in a manner which will avoid breaching of covenants, either overstating assets or understating liabilities. Make sure when you are playing the video, actually play this video. Don't combine videos and play them at once. Play it as a separate lecture on its own. If you haven't done that, or if you had played it casually, redo it again, because as you say, I have already registered it as a revision done. Now, perhaps an expose of your CBE. Are you not seeing this video meeting? I have a Zoom lecture after 8:30. When I'm done with you, I will have a Zoom lecture which was ending at 11. This tells you that, can you imagine, 8:30. I was in lectures in the afternoon. 8:30, I have a Zoom lecture which will end at 11:30. But all you guys, you are writing your some are for CIMA, some are for ACCA. I'm teaching around 28 subjects in total. And all of you guys, you are all writing in June. And I was able to complete syllabus in 2.5 months. Remember, we started in March. We started mid-March, already we are done with the syllabus. We are almost halfway during revision. There's no way where you can get such deals. And I'm doing this for 28 subjects. And then I just ask you to be serious with one subject. And I ask you a simple question. Can you just finish the question bank that I gave you? I gave you the question bank. And I said, I don't need much from you. Only finish the question bank. You know, as you say, for the 28 subjects I'm teaching, I have already finished all question banks. I know every question by head. Every question by head, I know. You can just choose it random and say, help me on this one. You will notice I will be explaining using things that you have not even asked me for 28 subjects, but I don't have an exam. And you are saying one subject is giving you a problem. Can you imagine, is that complaint valid when you are directing it to me? It won't be ideal, guys. Let us just sacrifice all other things and focus. The remaining 2 weeks are so crucial for our exam success. Please, may you type noted, say, whilst I'm opening the CBE practice platform. May you type noted, say, on that one. May you type noted, say. There's need now to get things right. There's now need to put my house in order and sort out the issues. Right. So notice here, I'm having just 3 minutes, not much. I just want to show to open in your paper on the CBE practice platform. You notice the exercise I'm doing now, I've already done it already in the videos. So, and as ACCA, there are a lot of videos that ACCA makes available to you. Make sure you register. If it's a webinar, if it's a student debrief, if it's what from ACCA, especially all about teaching you how the CBE practice platform works, continue to fine-tune yourself. As you say, I have done a lot in this. Because I gave you the assignments on CBE, and those assignments, I have been tracking your progress, and I'm about to begin marking. So I'm going to mark your assignments. But suffice to say, your paper is SBR International. It's international. And then ACCA resources. I just want to again show you how it looks like, though it might be pretty in nuisance, because you guys, you already know that. But because, as you say, I don't want to take chances, so allow me to just have a snippet of how your exam looks like. This is section A, question number one. You click next. Now, this is question number one. So you do notice when you're doing question like this, there's acquisition of grape. It's actually banana group. So banana group has made a lot of acquisitions and disposals during the period. So so you'd notice in this particular question, there is acquisition of grape. So you'd notice if you just open acquisition of grape like this, you'd notice there's a requirement for on acquisition of grape. Come up with an explanatory note. So it's still the same issue. How good you should have been calculated on acquisition of grape, and show the accounting entry which is required to amend the finance director's error. It is these parts of the questions, especially questions which say, show the accounting entries required to amend the error. These questions now are the questions. So you open your word processor, you explain how good you should have calculated, then you calculate goodwill, perhaps, and come up with the accounting entries to correct the error. So you just link and say, computations in working one indicated that the correct goodwill was. Therefore, the accounting entries to correct the error are as follows. But on these ones, I have, because I said just 3 minutes, on these ones, I have a video for this. This is the video which I have sent to you. May you please, I am repeating. I was already opening it. May you please, especially this video here, which I'm saying groups, there's a video which is here, this video which is group illustrations. Now on this one, I want you to use, there was a handout which I give your colleagues, which we used for illustrations. Now, let me again attach that handout so that when you are playing the video, you will first print or read the handout in advance before you open. So this is groups illustrations. This is the handout I'm talking about, class illustrations. There was plenty of illustrations, and we focused more on accounting entries to correct director's error, right? So, accounting entries to correct director's error. So what I'm doing here is use this handout as you play the video on groups illustrations. With this, I can safely say, as my students, we are already done for today. This is quite a lot that I've given you now. So enjoy the rest of your week, and